Welcome to This Week in South Carolina. I'm Gavin Jackson. This week we have a legislative update and we look at the Democratic presidential primary. And to do that, I'm joined by Maayan Schechter with South Carolina Public Radio and Jeffrey Collins with the Associated Press. Y'all, welcome to the new set.
Hello, Gavin, and welcome back to South Carolina.
Thank you. It's a great little coming home present here having this new set. So let's break it in. Jeffrey, let's talk about the State House and what's been going on. We're about a month into session right now. And this week we had a big debate going on in the Senate over a House-approved constitutional carry bill dealing with guns. What's the latest on that? They had a late Wednesday night. Where's the bill stand right now?
The Senate has now changed the House bill that came over to them. So there was a compromise that came up about 11:45 on a Wednesday night. And the compromise essentially would create a system where people could get free training to get a CWP, a concealed weapons permit. And the cost roughly, Shane Massey's estimating, Senator Shane Massey, $4 to $5 million, although they didn't get like a true, like normal, like financial impact statement. Mm-hmm. And what that would allow is people could go and get training. But that being said, you don't have to get the training. It's open carry of guns. If you're legally allowed to carry a weapon, you can carry a weapon, you can carry it in open, you can carry it wherever you'd like to carry it. And so what the compromise does too is it adds the stick part of it is if you are open carrying and you carry a weapon somewhere you're not supposed to, somewhere that weapons are prohibited, there'd be an extra penalty on top. So the thought is we're trying to encourage people to go get that training so they could learn, you know, how to properly use a weapon, the laws around that kind of thing and everything, kind of a CWP, concealed weapons permit light kind of program.
Yeah.
But essentially what it comes down to is this is going to allow people to open carry guns. There also is the provision that the governor has been pushing for very hard that increases penalties, state penalties, if a felon is carrying a gun or someone that isn't supposed to carry a gun is carrying a gun when they commit a crime. And that's been a big part of this. That's what the governor says. He'll sign that whatever you attach it to.
So is that still part of the bill you said?
That is still part of the bill.
Okay. So yes. That's kind of a big way of getting that through and also getting law enforcement somewhat on board with this because they're a little touchy about this bill.
Right. This bill, law enforcement is not particularly, well, not all law enforcement, but a lot of them are not particularly happy because situations where, you know, you show up somewhere and several people have a gun and they have to quickly assess who's a threat and who's not, you know, all of a sudden it allows things to escalate a lot more quickly because people may have guns in their possession that they wouldn't have had before. So, but part of the deal was law enforcement said, if you can give us those extra penalties, then okay, we'll be okay with it.
Yeah, because right now in South Carolina, they passed that constitutional carry with training, that open carry with training, essentially. So you have to get your CWP training, but you can still carry openly. Now we're trying to go beyond that.
Right. There won't be anyone that can legally own a weapon can carry it without training if the bill passes.
Yeah, a little worrisome there, but we'll see where it goes because now it has to go back to the House at this point.
Right. And the House has, I mean, you know, we'll see. It just came up very recently, so I don't know where that people in the House stand. But it does give that penalty may give people some pause, especially people that think there should be the least amount of limits on you know, your Second Amendment rights as possible. It'll be an interesting debate in the House.
So not a poison pill, but definitely some way of maybe pausing this debate a little bit longer in the conference committee.
Certainly doesn't give the House what they want. So it certainly gives an opportunity for there to be some argument and debate.
Love to see that House and Senate working together in such a way. Maayan, speaking of the House, this week I kept hearing the phrase Florida legislation, or this is similar to the bill that we saw in Florida. I mean, I know Florida Governor Ron DeSantis is no longer in the 2024 race, but we have been seeing a lot of legislation that mirrors a lot of things that happened down in Florida. But this week we're talking about social media and then also pornography access. So what's going on here? What do those bills do and where'd they go?
Yeah, so first on those two bills, in large part, what they do is they're aiming to limit minors' access, exposure to pornography, to social media, in particular the latter without parental permission. Mm-hmm. Those bills, while there was some degree of debate on the floor, both passed almost unanimously, with the exception of Democrat Justin Bamberg. He opposed both of those pieces of legislation. But you're right in that there was a lot of conversation about Florida on the floor. Florida's House actually passed nearly identical legislation just last week. Mm. You know, stepping back for a moment, copycat bills are very routine, as both of y'all know, in the South Carolina State House and across legislatures all the time, especially when it comes to some of these hot topics, socially conservative issues, perhaps. We see identical bills being flooded in every single legislature across the state, South Carolina being no exception. Mm-hmm. on top of the fact that Florida's House also passed this, obviously, as you mentioned, Governor Ron DeSantis, when he was running for president, would often talk about all these conservative accomplishments that the legislature had passed. And so there was obviously a large cohort of legislators in South Carolina, big Ron DeSantis fans, mm-hmm. who would routinely say, well, if Florida's legislature can pass this, we are also a red state. We are also a red legislature. Why can't we pass this legislation? Mm-hmm. So, you know, we always talk about the fact that no one wants to be Florida, but this has been an interesting time where lawmakers want some of that Florida legislation to spill over into the South Carolina legislature as well. So it'll be also interesting, similar to this gun bill, where that goes. I mean, even talking to some lawmakers, it's difficult to prohibit entirely minors from having access to things like social media accounts and even pornography. So it'll be an interesting debate in the Senate if it even gets that far.
Yeah, because we have until May, and then, of course, after that, everything's dead. But, yeah, and then this also came on the heels of the gender-affirming care bill that went through the House, too, and that was with DeSantis coming through the State House at the same time. So a lot going on. And as the U.S. Senate Judiciary Committee just had all the heads of those social media companies before them for a hearing as well.
Right, and it's worth saying that Representative Brandon Guffey, whose son died by suicide at age 17 after being
sextortion
last year, was up on the Hill, met with Senator Lindsey Graham, was standing in back of Mark Zuckerberg, sitting behind those other execs when Mark Zuckerberg was asked to stand up and turn around and basically apologize. Mm-hmm. So he was there as well.
And we saw that bill get passed into law last year when it came with penalties and stricter regulation, oversight, and penalties, like we're saying about mm-hmm. sextortion when it comes to minors and social media and being extorted for, you know, images and such. So mm-hmm. that was a big accomplishment. A lot more bipartisan buy-in on that bill than what we saw this past week. And a lot of comments on the floor that we can't say on air, even though they were aired on ETV, because we do gavel-to-gavel coverage. So if you were watching, you got your fill, though. But Jeffrey, another big issue grabbing headlines this week and the past couple of days was the governor talking about this feeding program for over the summer for low-income children. There's been a lot of back and forth over this program and its ties to the pandemic. So kind of give us the lowdown on that and where that stands and what exactly goes into that program.
So this program started during the pandemic. It provides about $120 for a family that, you know, to on their what would be old food stamps on their EBT card. And it's done during the summertime when school's out because these children aren't getting lunch or breakfast at school. So the thought process was that we give them money, give their family money. They get a little extra food at a time that food may be particularly scarce. So to renew this program, the federal government is requiring, they're still paying the $120, still paying for the money itself, but they required states to pay half the administrative cost. And a number of conservative states, including South Carolina, decided they didn't want to pay for that anymore. And so far, the governor's main explanation for it is it's a pandemic program and we have to stop the pandemic spending at some point. But for Democrats, this has become a very big issue because ultimately it's not a whole lot of money if compared to, I don't know, $500 million for bridges or whatever big ticket item you want to pull out. But it does affect the you know, what they say are some of the most vulnerable people in South Carolina, poor children who are hungry. Mm-hmm. And they don't feel like they've gotten a really good explanation out of the governor on this. Now, the thing is, though, it's got kind of late in the game. The federal government required you to make your decision by January 1st. There's like a February 15th like administrative requirement where you have to say how you're going to do it. So it's unknown whether you could go back and resend this if you wanted to. Mm. There's been a couple of motions put in both the House and Senate, you know, resolutions where they're asking the governor to do this, but there just hasn't been last time I checked, there weren't any Republican sponsors. So mm-hmm. That's kind of at an impasse at this point.
Yeah, I was going to say, because we could never really seem to get a number pinned down on how much that would have cost, too. But when we're talking about having, $1.6 billion extra in the budget, we're talking about $10 million. I mean, how much is that when it comes to feeding kids who might need food over the summer to kind of, you know, keep going and educated?
And it's one of those deals where, you know, I think Democrats see this as it's just an easy win. I mean, mm-hmm. what's the problem with, I mean, just asking people just to explain what the problem is with this, and they just don't feel like they've gotten any kind of adequate answer. And plus, again, I think they see it as an ability to show people that it's a place where you can show that you're the differences between you and the Republicans.
Mm-hmm. There was no talk about, was Shannon Erickson, the Education House Committee chairwoman, talking about working around this somehow? Yeah,
I have not heard that yet.
Okay.
But I would not be surprised. Mm-hmm. I would not be surprised if at some point...
Or Katrina Sheely in the Senate, something like that.
Yes. I mean, I wouldn't be surprised. There's enough of... I mean, there's enough people in the Republican Party that have, that want, that can see this. And lunch, and school lunch and school breakfast is becoming a bigger issue, I think, across mm-hmm. the state. I mean, Katrina Sheely has pushed for, you know, free school lunch and breakfast for kids across the spectrum, you know, whether or not they can afford it, whether or not there's a program. So it wouldn't be surprised if there's some discussion about that.
Yeah, they clamped down on school lunch debt, too, previously, yeah. So... Maayan, speaking of education, this week we saw State Superintendent of Education Ellen Weaver before House Ways and Means Subcommittee about the budget, talking about what she needs for this year. What was she asking for in her budget for education, and how close was that to what the governor was proposing in his budget?
Mm-hmm. She asked for a lot of money. I mean, over 260, 70, I wrote this down just to be sure. Over $600 million mm-hmm. on a wide range of items. Wrote this down just to remind myself, $10 million to bring some sort of roving classroom to some of the poor areas of South Carolina that don't offer certain technical or skill-based programs. She's asking for nearly $273 million to increase teacher pay by 3,000, except with the caveat that school districts would have to add 5 professional learning days, which is not exactly widely supported by a lot of teachers. And then there's the $30 million ask for the education scholarship account, what we also consider school vouchers. You know, that program itself hasn't started yet, and we know that there's still going to be this constitutional question. The South Carolina Supreme Court is supposed to start hearing arguments over that in early March. But what was interesting is during her hearing, she was asked a lot about, in particular from Neil Collins, Pickens Republican, asked about whether that money was coming out of traditional education funding, and she kind of pivoted and said no. But there is some disagreement from a lot of lawmakers over whether that is the case. Anyway, compare that money is in the governor's executive budget, but when you compare her budget request, which is pretty big, to what the governor is asking, there are massive differences. Obviously, the governor has to balance what she's asking with tons of other agencies mm-hmm. around South Carolina. So it is very massively pared down. So, you know, and I do want to make the point, you mentioned the $1.6 billion, the new money that economists or the Revenue and Fiscal Affairs Office has announced. As we know, while that may seem like a lot of money to most people, when you start looking at all the requests that come in from agencies, and then when you start looking at what lawmakers are already have to prioritize, like rising healthcare costs, that money evaporates very, very quickly. Mm-hmm. So it never hurts to get your budget requests out there and be loud and proud about it as an agency director. But certainly that money is going to disappear probably very, very fast this year. And so it'll be interesting to see outside of maybe perhaps the $30 million for the ESA, what else she's able to get mm-hmm. out of that request.
Possibly teacher pay raises in line with the governor. Again, he's mentioned, like, you know, the starting pay right now is $42,500. He wants to get to $45,000 because it's part of his goal to get to $50,000. I mean, is that something we could probably see happen, you think, just because that's something everyone agrees with?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's pretty reasonable out of that request. I mean, I really do think this adding the additional days is really going to be an interesting debate if mm-hmm. that does come to it, if that is what winds up being the actual case in the budget. Because, I mean, I haven't talked to a lot of teachers, but the teachers and the teachers groups I have talked to have not particularly been super warm to this idea of adding more time onto a teacher's work schedule. Because, of course, despite the fact that you may say, oh, this is more time for professional learning, well, you know, school districts could muddy that up a little bit. So anyway, it'll be interesting to see whether that happens. But I do think that there is large support, obviously, of getting teacher pay up in the state.
Mm-hmm. Anything you want to add on
that? No, I'm good.
Well, we can maybe talk a little bit about what the governor said in his State of the State address. Maayan, I want to stick with you about that. That's his time last week to lay out his plan for lawmakers. Like we said, he rolled out his executive budget earlier in the month, and then he kind of talks more about it in detail for about an hour, he did last week. There are some hot moments, some spicy moments, some funny moments, and then just a lot of details. What stood out to you during his speech?
Well, you're right. I mean, the speech in and of itself was a bit of a rehash of not only his executive budget that we've already heard about earlier this year, but also previous State of the States. I mean, he talked about wanting more executive branch input into the judicial reform debate. He talked about all the capital investments, historic investments that have come to South Carolina. He talked about the environment. So we've heard all of those greatest hits before, right? But probably the spiciest moment, and I think most of reporters sort of agreed because we all tended to have the same headlines on our stories, was what he said about labor unions and wanting to fight labor unions to the gates of hell, which is a pretty aggressive statement to make. You know, it's interesting, that statement. I mean, there hasn't been a lot of news about the longshoremen's debate over on the coast. There has been some activity, especially last year, where we were seeing kind of union workers and trying to get people in retail, you know, whether, or even Waffle House or Publix, to start speaking up more. But there really hadn't been a lot of activity. What I did think was interesting, however, and again, we're in an election year, so everything is, you know, politicized a little bit. Well, everything is politicized, but was that same day President Joe Biden received the endorsement of the United Auto Workers Union. And so obviously, as we know, Governor McMaster is supporting former President Donald Trump in his endeavor to get another term. So I wondered a little bit if that had anything to do with it in the state of the state.
Yeah, especially with the large automotive industry that we have in South Carolina, particularly EVs.
Right, and he did make a point, obviously, talking about all the capital investment that came in. That includes the EVs, whether it's BMW or Scout Motors. Mm-hmm. And so obviously there is a tie-in to that. And I'm sure, you know, that has been a conversation between his office and also these auto worker companies.
Yeah, the full quote was, "We will not allow the Biden administration's pro-union policies to chip away at South Carolina's sovereign interests. We will fight all the way to the gates of hell, and we will win." Jeffrey, very reminiscent of kicking the unions with 6-inch heels on of his predecessor.
Yes, yes.
But he doesn't wear heels, so he has to say something else.
And, I mean, it was like Maayan said, it was the one moment in there that kind of, that was not expected. I mean, the thing that, when I'm watching the State of the State address, we're all comfortable. Everybody's comfortable now. I mean, you know, Governor McMaster's been here a while. Mm-hmm. We're not quite to the point where he's like legacy right now. Like, you know, he's still got a couple of years left. So it was just kind of hitting the same points that he's hit before. Mm-hmm. We didn't have the tension in the room that we always would have with Governor Haley or Governor Sanford, where, you know, because Governor McMaster wants to get along with everybody. Yeah. So, and there was the NASCAR reference and there was the pop music reference. So it was a very comfortable
Joni Mitchell. Yeah, not the Spice Girls, but Joni Mitchell.
Yeah, we went back a little bit for this one. We went back in the
But I do want to mention this too, because I think this is something that visually we've all seen. I mean, since COVID, I think the state of the state has not been as highly attended as it was. I think COVID obviously like really hurt a lot of things. And so what was interesting on top of, you know, the fiery part about the labor unions and the speech itself was that there weren't a whole lot of lawmakers in the room this year as opposed to previous years. I mean, there were even, when I saw the cameras going across the room, staff sitting in some of the chairs, a lot of people had guests, and even lawmakers were tweeting or posting that they weren't going to be there this year as opposed to previous years. So that really also kind of stood out. Mm-hmm. I mean, again, we are in a very highly politicized moment, so that could be part of it. But I just think the rooms have gotten a little bit, I don't know.
Yeah, and we did see the governor jump on Fox News recently talking about the whole debate over the border in Florida and all that. Texas, hard to get them both confused, but you know. so doing more of that kind of stuff where we saw his predecessors really getting out there more, but since he's not going for higher office, he's just maintaining at this point. It's been a little different, but it is a political election year, we should say, and of course with Trump and everyone coming through for the Republican primary this month, it's going to be even more ramped up. But speaking of that, Maayan, I want to talk about the Democrats, because this Saturday is the first in the nation Democratic primary. No New Hampshire, you did not have the first in the nation Democratic primary. That was unsanctioned by the DNC. We're having the first one because we have the right folks in the right places, and we did the right thing for Joe Biden, according to Democrats, back in 2020. So fill us in on what's going on with this primary, how we got it, and just what it's been like on the ground. A lot of folks have been talking about stories of, you know, disaffected Democratic voters. You've talked to some folks. What's the vibe like, and where are we right now?
Right. So as you mentioned, a year ago, the Democratic National Committee voted to make South Carolina first. The DNC, obviously led by South Carolina's very own Jamie Harrison. The move was backed by President Joe Biden, in part because of the state's diverse electorate who votes in the Democratic Party primary. Roughly two-thirds of the Democratic Party voting bloc here are African Americans. And obviously that electorate, as you know, coming from Iowa and also coming from New Hampshire, is not exactly the same in those two early voting states. And so we tend to be a better indicator of where black voters will land. And that's helpful, obviously, in Super Tuesday states that are typically a little bit more diverse. So we've seen a heavy presence in mm-hmm. over the past month or so, or past few weeks, from President Biden himself, Vice President Kamala Harris, her husband, First Lady Jill Biden. We've had governors here, we've had former governors here. Everybody in the Democratic Party has come to South Carolina, including, obviously, we have our very own prominent Democrat, Jim Clyburn, stumping for President Biden. There's two pieces of that. One, they want to energize black voters, right? They want to show the state, the nation, pundits, whoever, that these narratives about black voter concerns aren't all up to snuff, that mm-hmm. that really people are motivated, energized here to back President Biden. The other part is they also want to prove to all these other states, probably particularly New Hampshire Democrats, that we deserve to be first. South Carolina deserves to be the first state, because look back 4 years ago. Joe Biden lost Iowa. Joe Biden lost New Hampshire. He got to South Carolina. He got Jim Clyburn's endorsement, and bam, it propelled him through the Super Tuesday states, into the nomination, into the presidency. Mm-hmm. And so certainly I think that there's going to be an even greater push that after the Saturday, look, see, this is what we can do, and that's why we deserve to continue going first.
Yeah, and that'll be the big thing, looking forward to 2028, because obviously, you know, we can safely declare Joe Biden the winner of the South Carolina primary at 7:01 after polls close, because, I mean, yes, there's, you know, Congressman Dean Phillips on there, Marion Williamson, I guess, is still in the race in some degree. Spiritually, physically, I don't know, but like, so I think it's obviously safe to assume what's going to happen there, and the rest of the you know, the process for the Democrats at least. So it is a bit of a thank you to Joe Biden, but then the bigger question, like, we're looking at is 2028. Like, will we continue to be first in the nation? That's going to be for the DNC to decide going forward. But Jeffrey, let's switch to the Republicans, because that is still a competitive primary, regardless of what we saw with the Democrats on the ballot. So what's going on with, you know, Nikki Haley in this race? Still, a lot of people have been asking why she's still in this race. I've been feeling that question too. You know, they're also looking at possibly Democrats jumping in to go vote for Nikki Haley. You've covered her under her tenure. You know what Democrats, how they felt towards her during those years. Do you foresee anything like that happening when it comes to these open primaries in South Carolina?
I think, you know, people that follow politics, it's like a dream of theirs is, oh, you know, you're going to disrupt it. And this, it doesn't happen in very big numbers. It's probably not going to happen in South Carolina for one of the reasons you just said. I mean, Democrats, you know, yes, South Carolina's grown, but a lot of Democrats remember Nikki Haley's administration. Mm-hmm. And, you know, she wasn't very friendly to Democrats. I mean, you know, she's against gay marriage, against Medicaid expansion. I mean, we talk a lot about how she took on Republicans in the legislature and things like that, but I mean, she also took on Democrats, and she certainly would make them, you know, she certainly would use them as an example if she needed to make a point or something. So, I mean, it is an open primary, and I think there's not quite the big swath of independents that there is in New Hampshire that Sure. you can get. But there are people that you can probably that are independent enough that you're, and they're probably mm-hmm. going to end up voting in the Republican primary simply because, as Maayan said, the Democratic contest is not a real yeah. contest at all. It's there's not, you know, so you actually have a choice that you can make that seems, you know, a little more legitimate and a little more likely that you know, you could choose a winner in the Republican primary. That being said, though, it's going to be an interesting time in South Carolina. I mean, we've got a month. You yeah. know, that to me is very interesting, because typically South Carolina is a sprint. I mean, yeah. you know, they come from New Hampshire and it's like boom and mm-hmm. you're done. So this is like a slow boil. It's percolating slowly. Yeah. I'm interested in, I appreciate this blast from the past, right? We're going to have, you know, a couple of weeks of looking back at the 2010s mm-hmm. and from two very different lenses. One lens is going to say it was a great day in South Carolina on mm-hmm. the Haley side of things. The other lens, we're going to see a much different perspective on what happened during those years. Mm-hmm. Now, you know, there's a couple of factors that you can include in that. I mean, part of the thing is South Carolina continues to boom. I mean, certainly you can't argue that South Carolina ended up in a better place, you know, economically during Haley's, you know, 6 years. You can't, you know, that's there. Mm-hmm. You know, Haley was, her approval rating was in the high 50s when she, you know, went to the Trump administration and left office. Her successor has done a very good job too. I mean, Henry McMaster's approval rating is in the low 60s, mid 60s. Yeah. And I mean, so that plays a part in this too. I mean, it's not like, it's one of those deals where do you miss Haley, well, everything's still going really well. So that's, she's got to figure out a way that she can, you know, try to bring people back to those 2010s and get them nostalgic and get them thinking of what a great job she did, while also appealing to the 700, 800,000 people that have never voted for her before. I mean, she was last on the ballot in 14. Mm-hmm. That's 10 years ago, 2014. We've had almost a million people move into the state by since then, probably 500,000, 600,000, 700,000.
Which can benefit her since they haven't really known her that way. But yeah, at the same time, it's still difficult.
Those folks, most of those folks have had what? This will be their third, well, if you count primaries, their third, well, fourth or fifth opportunity to vote for Trump if you count the general and the primary and everything. So it's going to be a very interesting few weeks here.
In 30 seconds, Maayan, does she have a shot at actually winning the primary based on what you've been seeing with polling and other things?
I'll say this quickly. Obviously, as we know, we should never discount Nikki Haley. She's overcome political expectations many, many times. The numbers, however, make it a little bit obvious, and you're talking about the rise in population. Just out today, there was a new Monmouth poll that showed Trump with 58% of GOP voter support to Haley's 32%. And those are tough numbers to overcome in your home state, especially when you talk about these growing areas like Horry County that have become more red and very, very pro-Trump. Mm-hmm. So
it's going to be a fun month, but you guys will be with us for it. So we're looking forward to that. That's South Carolina Public Radio's Maayan Schechter and Jeffrey Collins with Associate Press. Thank you guys.
Thank you so much. Yeah.